It's a European at the front, an American at the back,
but above all, Asian through and through.
Can you guess what car it is? Well, you've probably already seen it by the YouTube title, so no surprises there. But anyway, it's a Hyundai XG350. Welcome everyone, my name is Edward, and welcome to another review here on Ed's Auto Reviews. And who is a better person to present you this car than the owner? Which is me. That's right, this car is my very first and very own car. Look, I at one point needed a car, and I really wanted my first car to be an American, kind of a rare and unique and obscure car. But considering the fact I live in a country with the second highest gas prices in the entire world, and a government that tries to actively financially ruin you even if you only start to think of owning a car, I settled for this, the entry-level luxury car, the Hyundai XG350. Why? Well, because to be honest, it kind of looks like a baby Lincoln Town Car to me. More on that in a moment. And this is still a rather obscure car. Only 50 are known left to exist in the Netherlands. In fact, after 1.5 years of owning this car, I only once encountered another Hyundai XG350. And that was quite a, it was a little moment. I saw the other driver, we waved, we flashed headlights, and it was just a beautiful little moment in this world. And guess how much I paid for this thing? Lower. A lot lower. Way lower. Wait, okay, easy now. That might be a little too low. Just a little up there. Right there. Stop. Right there. $2,700. $2,700 for this. A supposed to be luxury car made by a car manufacturer that back then was the least associated with luxury. And that's what we're going to find out today. Today we're going to see how this car competes to the Mercedes E-Classes, Audi A6s and BMW 5 Series of that period. See, this was one of Hyundai's first attempts to create a luxury car for the US and European market, and not counting the Hyundai Centennial or Equus. That was for their own domestic market. See, Hyundai really wasn't off to a great start. Back in the 80s and the 90s, they had the Hyundai Pony, and when I say Hyundai Pony, people like my father would instantly cry of laughter and say, well, you didn't want to be seen dead in one of those things. But Hyundai is on a roll recently. I'm not a Hyundai fan. I am a Hyundai fanboy, but Hyundai is on a roll. I mean, they have this new generation of electric cars. They got hydrogen cars, and they even launched their own luxury mark, Genesis. And this car is kind of the granddaddy of Genesis. But first, let's talk design. I had this YouTube post not long ago where I showed you a very, very vague photo of the grille part and the headlight part. And you could guess what it was. And we had some guesses that were into the right direction. Some of you said Lancia, which I can understand because of the waterfall grille. Some other people said Daewoo. I can also understand, it's kind of like in the same corner as Hyundai. And some of you said the Maybach 57, and boy must you be disappointed, because this is not a Maybach. This is just a Hyundai that kind of looks like a Maybach. But let's think for a moment, because this car came out in roughly in the late 90s. This is the 2005 model. Very last year of this model, but the original car came out in 1997 or 1998. The Maybach came out in the early 2000s and looks a lot like this car. So really, who is copying who? Is Hyundai copying Maybach, or is this car, does this car have the $1 million look, and is Maybach just copying the luxury model of Hyundai? You tell me what this car looks like. Some other people pointed out that it kind of looks like a Lincoln Town car, me included, or Lincoln LS. But really, it's one of the most generic cars to look at from the front end, because it lacks any form of badging. No hood ornaments, no car logo, no inscription that says Hyundai, just nothing. Really, literally nothing. I've had people at car shows or I don't know, somewhere else, that look at the car and think, what is it? Well, this car is not gonna tell you, not at the front. And so design-wise, we come to the side of the car, which I really like, because it has just the right amount of chrome. It has the chrome door handles, the chrome strip down here, and the chrome strip running across the greenhouse that kind of accentuates the windows. And that's about it, you know, no huge big chrome bumpers, just the right amount, not too less, not too much. And then there is one little thing about this car I really like, which are frameless doors. When I got the car and I showed it to friends and family, I was actually one of the last people to notice that my car had frameless doors, because all my friends said, hey, look, when I open the door, I only, well, the window is down, but I only can touch the glass. My car is like a metal bar going around it. I don't have that because I got frameless doors, and I love it. Because to me, it kind of feels American. You know, if you step into the car, you just roll down the window, you grab this piece of metal, you get into your car and just, you know, slam it. And so we come to the back of the car, which, as I said in the intro, kind of looks like, like a Lincoln Town Car to me, especially because of the tail lights that kind of curve around the corner from the side and from the rear. And also the license plate that is placed not in the rear bumper, but in the like the trunk, which is, I don't know whether it's really American, but you know, it kind of feels American, especially Lincoln-ish to me, especially with the reverse lights that are also within the same chrome surrounding. And last but not least, the bumper with the little chrome accents, and it's also kind of sticking out, once again reminding me of a Lincoln. XG350. Sounds a bit nondescript, and it kind of is. It has been presumed that XG stands for Extra Glory or Grandeur, because this car is part of the Grandeur series, the generation before it was named the Grandeur, and the generation after it was named the Grandeur, and in some other countries it was named the Grandeur, but in Europe at least it was called the XG. So Extra Glory, Grandeur. And the 350, well, that is a direct reference to the engine. The car is powered by a 3.5-liter V6, no turbo, and 200 horsepower, or 196, but I always like to round it up to 200. It's the Sigma V6, and you could also get it as the 2.5-liter and the 3-liter V6, resulting in the XG250 or the XG300. Welcome into this car interior, as you can see. It is spacious, and you have a lot of configurations when it comes to adjusting the seats. The color is, take a look.
Because it's stylish and it's contemporary.
Every time I see you, those are the words that pop into my head, stylish and contemporary.
Thank you.
After other words like, for instance, beige, Stana Stairlift, the war.
Can you think of any more?
Homosexual.
I object to the beige.
Look, I really like some color in my interior. You know, today's cars with all the black plastic and the black cloth seats, and this has a bit of, you know, color to it, but the color they chose is, I don't know, it's beige, but really it's the wrong kind of beige. So from the outside it might have a rather expensive looking design, but on the inside you can really see that's a Hyundai. Because the interior is plastic fantastic. Every single thing is just cheap plastic. I mean, like, the wood is not real wood, it's plastic wood from I don't know what factory. It's not from the finest trees in the Amazon. It's probably just some plastic trees from a factory in South Korea. And everything, it really shares the buttons with all the lesser Hyundais. When you get into this car on a hot summer's day, if you get into a Jaguar in a hot summer's day, you are greeted with the smell of wood and leather and tobacco and whiskey. If you get into this car on a hot summer's day, then you just smell warm plastic. Now, this car is fitted with a 5-speed automatic, and the story goes that they co-developed it with Porsche. And it's just standard PR&D with the manual override, but I bought a automatic, not a manual, so why would I ever do this? But then again, I am a true car lover, so I decided to buy myself an automatic. The back seat is quite spacious, and I would kind of expect that the most important people in this car would sit in the back. But there is not a lot to it. You can't adjust the rear seats, it's not heated, and so, like, the only thing is that it is spacious. I mean, you got some air vents down here, but you do not get to control it. Only the passengers in the front can decide whether you get warm or cold air into your face. The only redeeming factor on the, like on the rear seat, is this, the center armrest. And if I open it up, then, ooh, that's where I keep my drink collection. How many more takes are we gonna do? Six. Six more takes. Okay. I don't care. YouTube Live is very stressful. And now, the trunk, which is big and spacious. It has proven itself many times that it is rather convenient to have such a lot of space. I mean, is... What? Oh, sorry. We have to interrupt our program for a quick message from our sponsors.
My name is Sweet Daddy E. All throughout life, I had side hustles. I dealt in illegal credit cards. I sold coke.
And now I'm part of the pimp game. I'm part of the Car Recommendation Association for pimps. And I, me, Sweet Daddy E, a pimp, recommends the Hyundai XG350 because of its luxury, its ride, its quality. It's just the perfect car. And also for another thing, the trunk. See, in my work, you come across a lot of different types of characters, customers. And some customers are just too eager and really want to do it right on the spot, or they can't pay for a hotel room. So that's why I chose the XG350, because it's like a hotel room on wheels. Is that one of our sponsors? Well, I don't like it. This is not the way to represent my channel. I mean, how many times do I gotta tell you that? Crap. Hello and welcome back to this review. So, time for a little drive. As mentioned before, 3.5 liter V6, 200 horsepower. You know, it is kind of like how Rolls-Royce would describe their cars when it comes to performance. This car isn't fast, it is swift. This car doesn't accelerate, it advances. And it doesn't really have a lot of power, it has plenty. Like I said, 200 horsepower, the weight is really a disadvantage for this car, but the 0 to 100 kilometers an hour time, or 0 to 60 miles an hour, is just under 9 seconds. Not fast, but still quick. I mean, I can perfectly keep up with modern day traffic, and it's nice to have the extra power available to you when you need it. Little tip from edsautoreviews, never solve a traffic situation with speed, but sometimes, always use your brake, but sometimes you really need it. But to really show you the true potential of this car, how about a little drag race?
The drag race is between my Hyundai XG and a Volvo V40 D4. I'll give you a moment to take a look at the specs. Bit of a shame, really.
And then there is the suspension of this car, which I absolutely love. Look, from a scale of, you know, the suspension so hard that your kidneys are all the way up your throat, to so soft that Captain Pegleg, the scourge of the seven seas himself, gets seasick because of the wallowing, the Hyundai has found the sweet spot. It's probably a little too stiff for an American, way too soft for us Europeans, but for me, it is just perfect. You know, it really floats down the road. I once drove a mid-60s Lincoln Continental Coupe, and okay, that is like the true exaggeration of soft suspension. Like, if you went over a bump, you could still feel it 5 kilometers after you've gone over it. But this car, it's just perfect. Really, it's soft, it floats, but it's never as severe as the Lincoln, as in that it really starts to lean over in corners. If you're looking for a BMW, this is not the car that you want to get. More on that in a moment, because here comes a little little old bump, and just, you know, like a magic carpet ride. Oh, I really like a soft ride. I mean, the soft suspension does come with a disadvantage. The steering, well, there is no steering. You're aiming this car. When this car came out, it really wasn't renowned for like very direct steering, but over time it has gone worse. I mean, look at this. This is the dead space. We only have like a slight wobble here. I'm not even turning. I'm still going straight, but this is just the dead space. This has way over boosted power steering. You know how when you start to learn driving a car that you have to keep your hands on like 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock, or the other way around, 9 o'clock, 3 o'clock. Unsubconsciously, I drive like this, you know, I just squeeze the steering wheel between my index finger and my thumb. This is, or as sometimes it's called, this is pinky finger steering at its finest. Just, I can just drive like this. It'll just go in the direction I want. It requires really no effort at all. If you want to get yourself a BMW or a car with BMW driving dynamics, don't get this car. This is for straight road cruising and nothing else. I truly love it. Because I'm not really a racer, I'm a cruiser. So, let's wrap this up. If you are the type of guy that wants a fairly big car that is comfortable and luxurious, that looks kind of like an American car, but doesn't have the American quality, but you have reliable Asian quality, and you live in a country where the gas prices really aren't that high as it is right here, and you just want a comfortable ride, value for money, and if you also do not care if it has the Mercedes star on the hood or the four chrome rings in the grill, get yourself this. It is the ultimate budget cruiser. You feel rich, while at the meantime you don't look rich. And really, I'm happy with this car. I have this now for about 1.5 years. And every single time I get in with a big smile, and every single time I get out of the car, I always look back for a little moment to look at it and think, nice.
Nice.